Bhagavad Gita is a sacred text. Bhagavad Gita, Mahatma Gandhi calls her as mother. Ambatvam anusandhathami Bhagavad Gita bhavadheshini. She is mother. Whatever mother does, all those things are done by Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is taking care of us. Bhagavad Gita can guide us in our life. Bhagavad Gita is compassionate to us. Such a great Gita we have. But there is another dimension which I wish to bring to your focus. Bhagavad Gita is a scripture of contradictions. And there are so many seemingly contradictory statements and elements in Bhagavad Gita. Let me give few examples of that. This shloka is well known. Karmanyeva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadachana. We all know the meaning of this shloka. The core bhava of this shloka, tone of this shloka is this. Don't get extremely attached to the results of the action you do. Just you do your duty, don't get extremely attached towards the results of those actions. This is the meaning, this is the bhava of the shloka. Then, in some other context, Sri Krishna says, Hato va prapsyase swargam, jitva va bhokshyase mahim. If you win the war, then you will rule this mortal land. If you don't win the war, you will enjoy the heaven. So here, he encourages Arjuna in research. It's very obvious. So these two statements seem to be contradictory. Just I am giving few examples, okay. Next example. Vedaischa sarvaihi ahameva vetyaha vedanta krita veda videva chaham. So beautiful statement. All the Vedas talk only about divine, only about me, only about divine. The passages in the Vedas, not mere Upanishads, but the whole of the Vedic literature, including Samhita, Brahmana, Aranyaka, the intention of the Veda is Brahman, divine and divine alone. Veda is Chaturvaihi, Aham Eva. Eva is just I am translating Eva as alone. The purpose of the Veda is the Brahmajnanam, Vedanta Krita. And I have uttered the Vedanta, Veda Videva Chaham, and I am the witness, I am the knower of all the Vedas. This is what Krishna says. So Krishna clearly says that Veda is a book of wisdom, it's a scripture of wisdom, and it gives Brahma Jnana. This is what Sri Krishna says in this, it's the purport of this shloka. And in another shloka, Yam imam pushtitam vacham pravadanti avipaschitaha veda vada rataha partha nanyadasti iti vadinaha. There are some scholars who always quote Vedas, but they don't know anything beyond some materialistic benefits. They get constricted to that alone, talking always about by this ritual this fruit will be attained, and by that ritual that fruit can be attained. Their mind is completely blocked and they are completely constricted towards that. So they cannot get elevated in spirituality. Don't follow them. This is what Krishna says in the Gita. So these two statements, I am not telling that these are contradictory, but they seem to be contradicting each other. The next statement, Krishna is talking about soul. Na jayate mudyate this is a shloka. Soul neither takes birth nor dies. And in the same context, after a few shlokas, Krishna says, Atha chainam nitya jatam nityam va yadi manyase jatasya hi dhruvam mrityuhu dhruvam janma mrutasya cha. If you consider soul as an element which is born, nitya jatam, then you come to this logic, jatasya hi dhruvam mrityuhu, whoever is taking birth has to die. Krishna says this. Next example. Sadhushra pichaya papeshu samamuddhihi visishyate. One who maintains equilibrium in his mind while viewing sadhus and the poppies, good men and the sinners, saints and sinners, he is great. Samaha shatravcha mitrecha. To him, to whom enemy and friend are equal, he is a wise man. This is what Krishna says in one context. In another context, he says, Jitva Shatruna Bhumsharajyam Samurtham. Wage war with these enemies like Duryodhana and Dushasana and conquer them, win them, and get back your property. This is what Krishna says. So, in one context, he is encouraging Arjuna to wage war. In another context, he asks Arjuna to see enemy and friend equally. These are the two statements which we are coming across. The same way, when he is talking about his own character, Krishna says, Name Deshyosti Na Priyaha. Okay, fine. In one context, Krishna says, that karma is inferior to jnana. Dureya hyavaram karma. Hyavaram means inferior. He avaram. Buddhi yoga tu dhananjaya. O Arjuna, this karma is inferior to buddhi yoga. Buddhi yoga means jnana. Therefore, buddhau sharanam anvichaya kripanaha alahetavaha. Therefore, take refuge on this jnana. And those who are attached towards the results of karma are poor. Kripanaha palakaitava. This is what Krishna says in one context. The very next chapter Krishna says, Asmat yogaya yujasva yogaha karmasa kaushanam. You act, you do your action, and you be in yoga. Yoga definition. To be an expert in your action is yoga. Yogaha karmasu kaushalam. In one context, Krishna asks Arjuna to act. In another context, he says action is inferior to jnana and Arjuna has to take refuge on jnana. This is a contradictory statement. I don't view this as a contradictory statement, but Arjuna views. Arjuna says to Krishna, Vyamishrenaiva Vakyena Buddhim Mohayasiva Me. Arjuna says to Krishna, you are confusing me by talking both karma and jnana. This is what Arjuna says. Therefore, please tell me which is superior and which is inferior. Clearly, please tell me. Sanyasam Karmanam Krishna Punar Yogam Cha Samsasi. You are talking about karma and again you are talking about jnana, then you are talking about karma. Vada ekam nischitya. You decide one thing for me and tell me. This is what Arjuna asks Krishna. And you see, these are all very interesting contradictions. See, these kinds of contradictory statements. It's not that one chapter is contradicting another chapter. One statement is in the same shloka, in the same verse, one statement is contradicting another statement. Amrutam chaiva mrityuscha. Brahman is both mortal and immortal. Sat asatcha. Aham. Not even he is talking Brahman. It is not in the third person. As a third person he is not talking. It is just him. I am both mortal and immortal. Sat asat. I am both manifest and unmanifest. Asattam sarva bhut chaiva. I am beyond all but I am everywhere. Within all. nirgunam guna bhoktur chai. All attributes are upon me, but I am devoid of all attributes. Nirgunam guna bhoktur chai. Sarva indriya guna bhasam. I illumine all the senses. Sarva indriya vivarjitam, but I am devoid of all senses. Bahihi antascha bhutanam. I am in the outside world also and the inside world also. Acharam charam eka chai. I am mobile and immobile. It's not that I am inherent in mobile and immobile objects. It's not really like that. It's just telling I am mobile and immobile. Durastam cha antike cha tat. And this Brahman is existing far away and it is also intimate to us. All these kinds of statements Krishna is giving. And all these things are coming in the same shloka. It's not even the first chapter this shloka comes and the next chapter another way it comes. It's not like that. The same shloka, all these kinds of contradictory statements are coming. Then, this is really confusing. Karmani akarma yapashyed. You will be knowing all these shlokas. Okay, these are very famous shlokas in Bhagavad Gita. Karmani akarma yapashyed, akarmani cha karmayaha. Sa buddhiman manushyeshu sa yuttaha krishna karma kritu. Let me translate this shloka. One who sees karma in akarma and akarma in karma, he alone is intelligent among the humans. And he can be called as complete personality of actions. Krishna karma kritu. Okay. He has accomplished his actions. One who sees karma in akarma, probably we have to translate like this. One who sees action in non-action, one who sees non-action in action is intelligent in the human world. And he has accomplished the action in a perfect way. This is what Krishna says. This is again oxymoron. Then he is talking about his own nature again. This is another example. Ajobi sanana, I am birthless. Okay. I don't have birth. Ajobi sanana, sambhavami apamayaya. Being birthless, I am born. This is statement. Avyayatman, neither I am born nor I can get destroyed. Bhutanam isharobi sanana, being the Lord of the universe, having Prakriti, Prakriti Swam Adhishthaya. Based on this Prakriti, I take forms and names. I am taking birth in this mortal world. This is what Krishna says. This is again oxymoron. In one context, Krishna says, Dharma Samsthapanarthaya Sambhavami Ide Ide. I came to this world to establish Dharma. Yada Yada Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Bhavataya. Whenever dharma diminishes, I assume form, I take birth in this mortal world and I establish dharma. This is one statement. The same Bhagavad Gita, another statement, sarva dharma parityajya, mam ekam sharanam vraja. Give up all dharmas and just surrender unto me. This is what Krishna says. One who has come to establish dharma says give up all dharmas. Give up all dharmas. Okay. And this is the last one. Okay, yate chasi tatha kuru. It's a very famous quotation. Yate chasi tatha kuru. It means do as you wish. After giving the message of Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says to Arjuna, finally, yate chasi tatha kuru. Whatever I have to give, all those suggestions are given by me. But hereafter, do as you wish. Somebody was quoting this and said in a lecture, such a wonderful message with Krishna. No other religious scripture can talk like this. This Bhagavad Gita is, Krishna is a democratic God. So democratic, telling, if you don't follow me, you have to fall in hell. He's not talking like that. He's just telling, do as you wish. My duty is over, I have given suggestions, do as you wish. This is what Krishna says. such a liberal person Krishna is. This is what somebody was telling. After the lecture, I said to him, sir, that statement is fine, HHS in the talk, but just before that statement, you look another statement in Bhagavad Gita. Just before that statement, just before that shloka, there is another shloka, which is not quite often quoted. That is this. Atha chetam ahankaratu nasroshyasi vinamshyasi. What's the meaning? If you don't listen to my words due to your ego, you will get destroyed. You will get lost. Then do as you wish. In that context, this shloka comes. Okay. Without seeing the previous shloka, if you just say Techasi Tata, Krishna is also a liberalist. If you interpret in that way, that cannot work. Previous shloka is this, Adachetam Ahankarat Nasroshyasi Vinamshyasi. So this is how there are so many seemingly contradictory ideas, contradictory statements in the Gita. And based on these things, some critics, some scholars say that Bhagavad Gita cannot have a single author. Bhagavad Gita should have multiple authors. Many authors sitting together must have composed this Bhagavad Gita, or many authors belonging to so many times, so different eras, different times, they must have written several shlokas and added it to Mahabharata, which have become this Bhagavad Gita. You might have heard of this view, generally. This view is that perhaps the popular, well-known European view, okay, this Asiatic society view, fine. For that, they give this reason. There are contradictory statements in the Gita. Therefore, it cannot have a single author, is what they say. And certainly, they say, certainly, Bhagavad Gita is a later addition in Mahabharata, the whole of Bhagavad Gita, the 18 chapters, or interpolations in the epic Mahabharata, is what they say. Of course, this is not my view, I am just presenting their view, Puropaksha. Puropaksha means opposition's view, okay. Then comes Siddhanta. Fine. My view is different. Our view. Our view is different. We believe. We have faith in Bhagavad Gita. We feel the sanctity in the Gita. And we are clear. We feel that definitely Bhagavad Gita is part and parcel of Mahabharata. Is what we feel. In fact, my personal view is this. The whole Mahabharata appears to me as a huge commentary of Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is the crux which Vyasa wanted to give to us, but to that Bhagavad Gita he has written a huge commentary, that is Mahabharata. This is how I view the whole thing. Therefore, to me Bhagavad Gita cannot be a later edition in Mahabharata. Okay, I have given my view. My general view I can give. Bhagavad Gita's language style is consistent with Mahabharata's language style. Okay. Bhagavad Gita's language is loose, it's simple. It's not a Narikeda Paka. It's a Draksha Paka. Narikeda Paka means you have to break the coconut and you have to do something, you have to make efforts, then only you can take the elixir of the coconut. This is Narikeda Paka, Dandi style or Bhanavata style. Bhagavad Gita style is Raksha Paka. You need not break the shlokas to find out the meaning. Just anybody who knows a preliminary Sanskrit can understand Bhagavad Gita. And this Raksha Paka is the language style of Mahabharata, the whole of Mahabharata. It goes to Mahabharata, okay. Language style of Bhagavad Gita. Based on the language style, nobody can say that Bhagavad Gita is a later addition in Mahabharata. Mahabharata has interpolations. Mahabharata has few interpolations, no doubt. But we cannot say the whole of the Bhagavad Gita is an interpolation in Mahabharata. Language style is consistent with the Gita, Bharata. Fine. Next point. It fits in the context. But that is also that. It fits into the context. Before Bhishma Parva, Udyoga Parva occurs in Mahabharata. In Udyoga Parva, Udyoga Parva ends with an interesting anecdote. Uluka, the son of Shakuni, comes as a messenger to Arjuna from Shakuni. And Uluka is explaining lots of things like what are all the efforts of this Mahabharata war. If Mahabharata war occurs, how the people will suffer, like anything. And how many children may become orphans. How many women will be widowed. Therefore, why can't you stop the Mahabharata war and go to the forest for remaining days? This is how Uruka is talking in the end of Udyoga. But Arjuna rejects straight away the words of Uruka. Then comes this Bhishma Prabhupada starts with Bhagavad Gita. In Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna is repeating the same words of Uluka. Okay. Arjuna is brainwashed by Uluka. The same thing, he is putting down the Gandiva, his bow, and he is talking the same thing to Krishna. So those things, those imprints of Arjuna which he expresses, all those things are the suggestions given by Uluka. So, this fits into the context. To understand Bhagavad Gita, we should have a little knowledge of Mahabharata too. If you want to have a complete knowledge of Bhagavad Gita, if you have to appreciate Bhagavad Gita to its larger extent, then we should have some Mahabharata knowledge. Because definitely, certainly, the Gita becomes a part and parcel of Mahabharata. Anyhow, then, okay, fine, these are all fine. The language style is consistent and it fits into the context, all these things are fine. But still, that question is remaining. Why this much of contradictions? These kinds of contradictory statements, why these contradictory statements come in Mahabharata, Gita? Why? As these contradictory statements come, these Gita must have multiple authors. This is the Pura Paksha. But what I view is, my humble view, as these much of contradictions come in Bhagavad Gita, this should have a single author. The same, for the same reason. Okay? For the same reason, Bhagavad Gita has a single author. The reason which they give, there are so many contradictions, therefore it should have multiple authors. But what I view is, as there are so many contradictions, this should have a single author. How about why? A person's style is this. His unique style is this. Whenever he talks, he gives a seemingly contradictory statements. And that is Krishna. Okay? That is not only regarding the Gita. Throughout the epic, wherever the character Krishna comes, and wherever Krishna talks, go to Mahabharata and see that he seems to contradict himself. Okay? He seems to contradict himself. He gives seemingly contradictory statements. So, if you see this style of Krishna's talk, then we can understand the same Krishna has to talk this Gita also. Understood? You're following? Okay. That consistency is there. Wherever Krishna talks, his words are seemingly contradictory. Therefore, here also, his statements can become statements are arranged in this style of oxymoron. Fine. Oxymoron is this. What is oxymoron? Two words are there. They seem to be contradictory, but there is a synthesis. There is a reconciliation. Then that is oxymoron. And a very simple example, generally, while oxymoron is taught in schools or colleges, okay, in English literature, they give this example. This boy is regularly irregular in the class. Okay, he is regularly irregular. And this is oxymoron. Fine. It seems to be contradicting, okay. But these two words are not contradicting each other. Oxymoron, in Sanskrit we call it, Sanskrit also this figure of speech comes. This is a figure of speech for an information. Alankara. And in Sanskrit it is called as virodhabhasa. Okay. Abhasa means seemingly. Virodha means contradictory. Okay. Virodhabhasa. Karmani akarma yapasya. One who sees action in action. Sorry, non-action. Non-action in action. Okay. This is oxymoron. This is virodhabhasa. So Krishna's language style is of virodhabhasa and throughout the yogi. The same kind of language style he adopts in the whole Gita. Therefore, Krishna is the author of the Gita. In that way, we have to understand this. Many wise men give Vedantic message in the Mahabharata, like Sanat Sujata delivers the discourse of Vedanta to Dhritarashtra. And there are so many contexts in which Vedanta is spoken. Bhishmacharya in Moksha Dharma Parva teaches Vedanta to say Yudhishthira. Around several chapters, okay, probably 60 to 70 chapters, Bhishmacharya is going on talking about Vedanta. And those things are different. There we don't see seemingly contradictory elements. Okay. Only in Krishna, only wherever Krishna comes, we see this oxymoron style. Therefore, this Bhagavad Gita has to be, Bhagavad Gita belongs to Krishna. Bhagavad Gita is an exposition of Krishna. Swati. So what? Whether it is written by Krishna or not, is the author of Bhagavad Gita is Vyasa or not. So what? What is there? In what way is there written in literature? If this question occurs, it's not merely a scholarly exposition, which now I am going to present in front of you. I don't want just to show my scholarship. I just don't want to shape my oppositions. For that, I didn't take this topic. Its relevance in our life is very important. Oxymoron in the Gita, it has relevance in our life. You see, people who contradict their own statements, they must belong to two categories, okay? They belong to two categories. Two kinds of people only can talk contradictory statements. Okay. If somebody is giving contradictory statements, either he has to be an idiot or he has to be a dickhead. Okay. A fool gives contradictory statements, or a drunkard person can give contradictory statements. And a wicked gives contradictory statements. He doesn't bother about his own statements contradicting each other. To him, ultimate goal is this. His selfish purpose has to be accomplished. That's all. For that, he can talk anything. To find out somebody as wicked or not, this is a very easy technique for your information. Let me take Ramayana for example. Mantara is talking to Kaikeyi. Mantara says to Kaikeyi, "My dear Kaikeyi, your husband himself is your enemy. The greatest enemy you have is your husband." This is what Mantara says. Mantara threatens Kaikeyi. This is in one chapter. And after two or three chapters, the same Mantara says to Kaikeyi, "Kaikeyi, certainly the king Dasharatha will, by seeing you in this poor temperament, he will certainly give his oaths and certainly he will obey your command, because he is so doting you that he will give his own life for your sake." Okay. So, beyond these two categories, idiots and wicked people, beyond these two classes, there has to be a third class to which Krishna has to belong. Okay. There must be a third class which can give contradictory statements like this. What is the third class? Wiseman. Wiseman also contradict themselves. If wicked contradicts himself, it means if we decipher it, if we explore it, we can find out the reason behind it is his selfish purpose. But if a wise man gives contradictory statement, it has some other meaning. If we go beyond the statements, if we read in between the statements, okay? If we read in between the words, we can understand there is a perfect synthesis, okay? There is a perfect synthesis between these contradictory statements, these contradictory words can be reconciled. And this is a style of not only of Krishna, but of a few other wise men, like Sant Kabir. Sant Kabir's statements seem to be contradictory in his own granthas, in his own texts. In the same way, there are a few Vedic passages which adopt this style. The Vedas talk like this. In the Vedas, there are several oxymoron style. The same way, Ishavasya Upanishad, among the 10 Upanishads, this Ishavasya Upanishad is completely filled with contradictions. I mean, oxymoron. Okay. How the Upanishad starts? Ishavasya Midam Sarvam. Tekena Bhujita, the first mantra says, enjoy by sacrificing. Sacrifice and enjoy. Tekena Tekena Bhujita. Or God yourself by sacrificing the things. The very next mantra says, desire to live your life. Jiji Vishayati Shatam Samaha. And it talks about the nature of Brahman. There also, Akayam Avranam. Brahman is formless. The same Upanishad says, Yate Kalyanatamam Rupam Tattva Pasyami. O Lord, I am seeing your most auspicious form. Okay. Tadure Tadvantike. Upanishad says, Ishavasya Upanishad. Brahman is in distance and it is very near to you. And not only this, Anejat Yekam Manaso Jariyaka. Anejat means Brahman never moves. Manaso Jariyaha, it is the fastest moving principle. Manaso Jariyaha. Immediately, the same verse, Anejat Yekam Manaso Jariyaka. Fine. Then, Vidyamcha Avidyamcha Yastad Veda Ubayavum Sahai. Avidyaya Amrutyum Thirtha Avidyaya Amrutam Ashrute. One should know both Vidya and Avidya. And by Avidya, one crosses the mortality, and by Vidya, one enjoys the immortality. Sambhutimcha Vinasamcha Yastad Veda Ubayavum Sahai. One who adores both Sambhuti and Vinasha alone can evolve in spirituality. See, the whole Upanishad, almost the most of the passages in Upanishad I have covered, it has only some 16 or 15 verses. Okay. Almost in every verse, there is a contradictory statement in Ishavasya Upanishad. And it's a very important Upanishad because it is the last chapter of Shri Ranganji Samhita. Same language style is adapted by Lord Krishna that. And we should realize that if we see in between the words of these, in between the words, then we can understand there is a beautiful wisdom, wonderful wisdom beyond these contradictory statements. Behind these contradictory statements. Okay, leave this. Let me come to another point. I said no. Krishna's language style is featured with the contradictory statements. Okay, fine. Next point, let us take next point. Krishna's whole life history, okay,
is filled with contradictions. This is another interesting element we can see. Okay. In Buddha, we can see only Buddha. In Napoleon, we can see only Napoleon. Napoleon cannot become Buddha, Buddha cannot become Napoleon. Fine. Buddha is Buddha, Napoleon is Napoleon. But Krishna is both Buddha and Napoleon. Krishna is a warrior. Krishna is a philosopher. See, the whole life of Krishna seems to be filled with all these contradictory things, contradictory features Krishna has. Krishna is a playing child, an innocent playing child, nutcut balak. Same way, if you read Mahabharata, Udyog Guru and all, Krishna is a very serious man. How can these two things go together? Krishna is a sportive person, Leela Purusha. In the same way, Krishna is a man of silence. Krishna conveys silence to us. Krishna is extremely active. Krishna is extremely dynamic, morning to evening, hard work, roaming around the world, and establishing dharma everywhere. On the other hand, he is always in meditation. He always stays in absolute silence. By all these actions, his silence is not getting disturbed. See, these kinds of contradictions. These are all seemingly contradictory elements. And Shodasastri Sahasresha, Krishna is a man of romance. In our Archana, we do Shodasastri Sahasresha Yamaha, we say Krishna is a man of romance. And in the same Archana, there comes Anadi Brahmacharini Yamaha. Krishna is a man of celibacy. What is this? What does it convey? Krishna is a man of celibacy. And Bhishmacharya says in Mahabharata, I don't have that celibacy which Krishna has. Says. So Krishna is celibate. And Krishna is Shodasastri Sahasresha. Krishna is a Kudumbi, very big householder. And also he is a sannyasi. Sannyasi not in the sense he is wearing saffron robe. But we have to find out the meaning of this. Why he is called as a sannyasi? And why he is a householder? Being in Grihastashrama, how he is a sannyasi? And running such a huge nirvaha, such a huge administration like Dwaraka, building up such a wonderful empire, building up such a wonderful Yadava lineage's assert, yet not getting disturbed by all these things, just being a witness, free of stress. How this happens? What is the synthesis which makes him to do, which makes him to practice all these contradictory elements in a very sporting way? He is not doing all these things in an artificial way. I have to do this, I should do this, I must do this. He is not doing this way. It seems all these things appear to be a very natural thing in him. Naturally occurring, all these things naturally occurring in him. Like John Keats says, no? You will be familiar with this statement. Somebody asked John Keats, what is the cause of your poetry? How you get inspired and all? He replies, as leaves grow in a tree. Okay. This is a statement. Like that, all this, in a leader like Krishna, all these contradictory acts, okay, they appear to be contradictory, but they occur in a natural way. Natural way. In this context, I have to be wrathful. In another context, I have to be peaceful. Both can occur in Krishna. Okay, this is a leadership point. This we can see in very great souls. And it also, we can see also in very great leaders sometimes. Like as we were talking about Krishna, in the same day we see this in Rama too. In Rama, Rama is a great warrior. In the same way, he is a man of tranquility, calmness. He is very humble to the rishis. In presence of rishis, he is extremely humble. In the warfare, when he is waging war with Ravana, he is very harsh. He behaves rudely. If you read it, if you go through Yuddhakanda,
And when he is talking to Sita or Kausalya, he is very soft. But he is very rough while handling Kabanda or Virada, and he is very rough. Is this Rama talking like this? Rama whom we see in Ayodhya Kanda is different from Rama whom we see in Kishkindha Kanda or Yukta Kanda. How? Is this Rama behaving like that also? How is this possible? Interesting. The same way, he is both masculine and feminine. It goes to such a way, such an extent. That's what we see in Lord Shiva, Ardhanari Shiva concept. Rama and Krishna, they reveal their both masculine and feminine characters. Rama is humble, Rama is soft, Rama is gentle. The same way Rama is a warrior, Rama wages war. In psychology, in Jungian psychology, Jung says that there are two kinds of personalities, introvert and extrovert. Okay. First he invented or discovered these two kinds of personality traits, introvert, extrovert. Introvert is comfortable with himself. Extrovert will be happy in a crowd. Introvert can work all alone. Extrovert can work only when all others are working. Introvert will be disturbed if others are working. He alone has to work. Generally, introvert will be happy with aesthetic sense, aesthetic flow or art. Extrovert will be active and he will be gathering facts and figures. These are all the differences between introvert and extrovert. These two personality traits C.G. Jung is putting forth. But later in psychology, one more trait is discovered. It's a beautiful thing. They call it as? Anybody? Ambivert. It's called as ambivert. There are some personalities who are ambiverts. Like, they are comfortable with crowd also. They are comfortable to be all alone also. Rajimba, Vanavasova, Vanavaso Mahodayaka. Rama says no. I am comfortable with the forest also, I am comfortable with the kingdom also. If Dasaratha says, tomorrow you are going to get crowned. Then also Rama's face is serene and his calmness is not disturbed. But later, the very next day, Kaikeyi says you have to go to the forest and live all alone. Living all alone itself is a problem. Today we are hearing the story. Okay, giving up the kingdom and leaving the crown and making the hair matted, leaving the royal robes, being in attire of tree box, having tree box as vastra. All these things are there, but this itself is a problem. Living all alone in a forest is a very big problem for a human being who always moves with the people. But Rama doesn't bother. There is not even a simple context in Ramayana where Rama was weeping. Oh, I am all alone left. I am highly boring in the forest. He doesn't say that. He is extremely happy with the squirrels of the forest, with the peacocks and cuckoos of the forest. Okay. He is all alone, what is that? Far away from the maddened crowd. Far away from the maddened crowd. All alone in Chitrakuta or Panchavati, he is enjoying his life with Sita and Lakshmana. This is enough for me, he says. Then he comes back. For 14 years, he led a life like that, no? After coming back, what is that? Here the city life, very hectic, I am highly troubled in this huge crowd. He doesn't complain like that. In crowd also he is in crowd also he is happy. While he is all alone, he does work. He is working. Like before Setu Bhunda, he is doing tapasya, no? This is a lonely work. Nobody is participating in that. But he is comfortable to work for that. On the other hand, with a huge crowd also he was. He is gathering the Vanara Sena, Vanara army, all these things.
He is aggressive also. He is aggressive as well as submissive. He is aggressive while leading the Vanaras, while leading the army, his commander. He is extremely submissive. While seeing the sages, while seeing the hermits, the rishis of Dandaka, or his father or mother, he is submissive. Such seemingly contradictory elements are gathered in Rama. That is how we see in Krishna too. These kinds of heroes, were our ideals long, long ago. Later it got changed. But these were the ideals of us. If we start to follow these kinds of personalities, like Rama and Krishna, if we start to reflect to an extent, to a little extent, then we can succeed in our life. It is possible. We can't say that it is not possible. This is what Krishna is talking about, this shloka. In the shloka, he is talking about that. Karmanya karmaya pasye akarmani cha karmaya sabuddhiman manusheshu sayuktaha krishna karma krit. One who sees action in non-action, non-action in action, is intelligent, and he has accomplished his action in a complete sense. He is a complete personality. Now understood? Having based, this is my interpretation, okay? There are interpretations by great souls, just whatever I feel, I am telling here in this shloka, okay? Based on the silence, which is our core nature, which is our swarupa, we act. Attuning to that core silence, attuning to that akarma, this is akarma, non-action. Attuning to that akarma, when we start to act, we don't get bound to that action, we can be free to act. We are not bound to act, we are free to act, and we can also accomplish the completion in action. This is the sense, this is my interpretation. Okay. And my interpretation must be correct, because that kind of shlokas are there in the Gita itself. For example, yogastaha puru karmani, be in yoga and act. This is Krishna's command. Be in yoga and act. What's the meaning of this? Do asanas and act. Be in yoga and act. Yoga, the word yoga is from the root yuja samadhi. Yuja is samadhi. Okay. Samadhi means comes. Samadhi, the word samadhi literally means a trance and all those things are there. But its literal meaning in Sanskrit grammar is calmness, complete calmness of mind, internal peace. This is called a samadhi. So yoga means samadhi, yoga means internal peace, yoga means internal calmness. Fine. That is our swarupa. Patanjali also defines in that way only. Yoga, chitta vritti nirodha. Getting mastery over our own mental faculties is yoga, is what he says. Or stopping the mental faculties is yoga, he says. Chitta vritti nirodha. Stopping the mental faculties. Stopping the modes, mind's modes. This is yoga. What does it mean? When all the modes of the mind are stopped, you automatically, naturally start to enjoy your internal peace. This is because that is your nature. That is our nature. Sukhabhajaha prajasmruta. Happiness is our birthright. This is our nature. As this is our nature, when we stop our thoughts, naturally we get it. When we remove the dirt in the water, then what we have? We have wonderful water in the well. Well is filled with a lot of dirt. Therefore we think it as a dustbin. But an old man comes and says, no, before some 60 years, this was a well. Now tap is not working.
pipe is not working, therefore you can use it. Beneath this, there is water. Then the villagers come and they remove all the dust. While these dust are removed, what is remaining? Water. You need not fetch water from some other place. You need not bring water, you need not make some other effort. Your effort, our effort is just to remove the dust. The same way, here, when we start to remove the thought forces, finally what remains? We remain. Ours is peace. Peace alone remains. That's the key. That is called as yoga. This process also is called as yoga. Fine. This process is also called as yoga. Ultimate peace also is called. Being in ultimate peace also is yoga. Any effort to go to that ultimate peace also is yoga. Being in ultimate peace is yoga. This is Patanjali's definition. An effort to go to the internal peace is yoga. This is Vasishtha's definition. Manas prasamanopaya yoga ha. Yoga Vasishtha. Manas prasamanopaya yoga ityabhidhiyate. So, these are the two definitions for yoga. Interesting. Because sadhana is also called as yoga. Sadhya is also yoga. Samadhi is also yoga. Yama to yama, niyama, pranayama, up to pratyahara, everything is yoga. Dhyana, dharana, all these things are yoga. Fine. Why I am talking this? Yogasthaha Guru Karmani. Here, what Krishna means through this. He is not talking about the practice of yoga, but he is talking about the experience of yoga. That is, to be in internal peace and to work. If you work in that way, then we don't get disturbed. Stress is not affecting us. Okay. We don't, another important point. We don't identify ourselves with the action. Action is different from me. I am the witness. I just witness the action. With this witnessing bhava, witnessing mentality, the actions can be done. Guna guneshu vartante iti matva na sarjate. I am doing. Giving up this. Things are happening. These are all happening. Just I am witnessing. Things are happening. If the things can be done in that way, then what happens? I am not getting identified. Point number one. Point number two, as I am not getting identified, I am not getting bound to that action. As I am not bound to that action, next point, point number three, as I am not bound to that action, I can jump to any action as I wish. When I really understand, when I realize these actions are mere goals, I can impose upon me any action without having attachment to it. Therefore, I can play so many roles. I can give varieties of roles in me. And in my personality trait, all these roles can make me colorful. Okay, the whole life becomes colorful. Therefore, Krishna is also the charioteer. Krishna is also a messenger. Krishna is also a statesman. Krishna is also a Vedantin. Krishna is also a Yogeshwara. Krishna is also a warrior. And what not? Krishna is a guru. Krishna is a child, a playing child. Krishna is a man of sportive nature. Krishna is a dancer who dances upon Kaliya. And Krishna plays flute. Again, as there are some scholars who are getting confused by seeing the seemingly contradictions of Bhagavad Gita, they say, no, Bhagavad Gita has multiple authors. The same way, some scholars say, there are several Krishnas. In due course of time, in Hindu tradition, all these Krishnas are put together, they are made one Krishna. Because these scholars couldn't even imagine such a kind of personality can exist. Warrior is a warrior. How a warrior can become a Vedantin? How a Vedantin can become a yogin? How a yogin can become a nutcut balaka? Okay, a mischievous child. How this is possible? That's how they view and they say that several Krishnas are put together and they have made one Krishna. It's not like that. The single Krishna is resonating throughout the epic Mahabharata. So
So same Krishna, the same Krishna is there everywhere. And same Krishna is doing all these leelas. That's why these are called as leelas. Leela means play. Krishna is playing. Playing means the word play has two meanings. In Sanskrit, leela also has two meanings. Leela means a sport. Leela means drama. Play means sport. Playing means drama, play. This is Shakespeare's play, you say, no? So it's a play, it's a drama. Krishna comes, whatever roles he plays, he feels these are roles. So he is not getting struck with any role. Therefore, he can bring all these kinds of colorful dimensions in him. But the basis of all this colorful dimension is this. Which? The foundation. Drashtubhu, Surupe, Avastham. That pure consciousness, which is beyond the names and forms, which is beyond all attributes, which is the core peace alone, that is the foundation of all these roles which Krishna plays. Having that as foundation is making all these colors playing with everything. Just playing. Everything he plays. Fine. And throughout the life he practices this philosophy. The same philosophy he is giving in Bhagavad Gita also. As he gives that philosophy is a philosophy itself is oxymoron. This philosophy itself is oxymoron. Karma yoga. Yoga is silence. Karma is action. Karma yoga means the silence and action. That itself is a karma yoga, the very word is oxymoron. How silence and action can be? Sthiti gatimata virodaha. Okay. Either you can sit or you can move. How these two can go together? That's what we wonder. Karma, yoga, action and silence. Being in silence, act. This is what he says, he practices too. He practices too. And let us see these shlokas. Okay. Karmendriyani samyamye. Karmendriyani samyamye. Yaste manasasmaram. Indriyattham vibhudhatma mithyacharasya uchyate. Oh Arjuna asked that question, no? Already I dealt with that. You are confusing me with your statement. You are telling that you are glorifying karma and glorifying jnana also. Please tell me one thing. For that Krishna says, Arjuna, jnana is superior to karma. No doubt in it. Jnana is superior to karma. But one cannot remain without doing karma. Nahi kaschit kshanamapi jatu tushkat akarmakrut. One always acts, whether he wishes or not, he is acting. If he controls his voluntary actions, his involuntary actions are going on. Karyateki avasaha. Vasa is voluntary action. Avasakarma. Now we are just sitting. Voluntary actions are stopped. But involuntary actions, blood flow is going on and the heartbeat is going on. You cannot stop all those things. Karyadehi avashakarma. Therefore, it's not that you have to give up the karma just because jnana is superior to karma. It's not that you have to give up the karma. Here he says, Karmendriyani samyami. He is talking about the mithyachara. Mithyachara means hypocrite. He is talking about hypocrite. Hypocrite in the field of yoga is he. Karmendriyani samyami. Who is controlling his karmendriyas? Karmendriyas means his active senses. Okay. His hands, his legs. He is controlling all these things. But what he does? Manasas marana. His mind is highly active. He is telling that he is doing meditation. He is sitting. Malato karune sire. What is the poem of Sant Kabir? Manuvato dasa kisme sire. Sant Kabir says, in hand the mala is, japa mala is getting rotated. But mind to, this mind is rotating. And it's going to railway station, it goes to airport. All these things the mind is doing. And this is what a hypocrite's meditation. Okay. he is not hypocrite because he is cheating others. He is cheating himself. That is his me. I am a great yogi, he thinks, but unfortunately his mind is roaming. Even though he has controlled his karmendriyas, his antarindriya, mind is roaming. That is a lakshana, that is a feature of hypocrisy. But karma yoga is different from this. That Krishna says, see this shloka, how wonderfully Krishna brings out the philosophy of karma yoga. Yastindriyani manasa niyamyarabhate juna karmendriyai karma yogam asattasa visishyate. Please remember the meaning of the previous shloka. One who controls karmendriyas and allows his mind to roam everywhere is hypocrite. Next shloka, one who controls his mind, one who keeps his mind under his control and allows his karmendriyas to roam is a karma yogi. He is beautifully bringing this philosophy of karma yoga. His karmendriyas are roaming everywhere. For what? For, Krishna himself says, for loka sangraha, he says. Loka sangraha means for universal welfare. Loka kshema is loka sangraha. For universal welfare, his hands are active, his legs are active, all these things are active, but his he in his core is always attuned to that fundamental silence, fundamental peace. That's interesting. But is it possible? Is it possible? Krishna is talking about that. Definitely it is possible for Krishna. And I guess it is possible for Arjuna too. Arjuna is also eligible for that. But is it possible for us? That's the question. And I feel that it's possible. It's possible. For that, some technique. I just want to give some technique. Like every day, sit silently for a few minutes at least. Okay. With some practice, probably with Nama Japa, okay, taking one Nama, divine name. For example, taking Rama Mantra, Rama Nam, or Maha Mantra, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, or Triyodasakshari, Sri Rama, Jai Rama, Jai Jai Rama. Rashtrakshari, Namo Narayana. Taking this, and at least some 10 minutes in your puja chamber, puja room, in front of a deity, sitting and just doing the japa, chanting this Ramanama, chanting this Rashtrakshari mantra. While doing this, there are three types. Okay, Manu is talking about three types. For this only Krishna is giving that. How to achieve karma yoga? Is it possible? Karma yoga is possible. Then after delivering the discourse of karma yoga, in the sixth chapter, Krishna is deliberating. Krishna is delivering about dhyana yoga. Okay. How to meditate? Sit and meditate. Shanai shanai hi uparamethe buddhyadrati bhihitaya atma samstrambana kruttva nakinchi rabi chintaya. Whenever the mind is roaming everywhere, bring the mind again and again to that mantra. Be aware of that mantra. Let the mantra flow in the heart. That's how dhyana yoga is prescribed in Bhagavad Gita. Dhyana yoga is prescribed in between karma yoga and bhakti yoga. Therefore, it is common in both. Dhyana yoga is common in these two yogas. When we sit at least for some 10 minutes, calming the mind, calming the roaming mind like this, and having some Bahiranga yoga also, like offering flower to the deity or lighting the lamp. When we have this, without our own knowledge, if this is consistent, that is very important. Every day we have to do. It's not that in this day I have done 50 pranayamas and 50,000 times I have recited this mantra. in this day. Next day onwards, next 1 week, 7 days, I left everything. I was roaming everywhere, eating anything, and talking whatever I liked. All those things I did. Then I was reminded of my previous sadhana. Then I sat for 3 days. And then I was doing lakhs and lakhs of japa. And then I left everything. This kind of chaotic life is not advocated by Patanjali. Fine. Yoga Sutra is clear. Dirgha kala nayantaniya sakkala sevitaha dhradabhumihi. Satu dirgha kala nayantaniya. It's a beautiful sutra. Dirgha kala. Our sadhana has to be for a long time. To cleanse our heart, to cleanse our mind. Probably 15 years, 20 years. Dirgha kala. Then nairantarya. Nairantarya means not only 15, 20 years. It has to be consistent. Every day 10 minutes. Every day 10 minutes or every day half an hour. Okay. For so many things we have time. For this we don't have time. So nairantarya. Consistently every day 10 minutes or 15 minutes to do japa. Or to be aware of our breaths. Nairantarya. Then not only these two, satkara. Satkara means with a great interest. While we are sitting for the japa, we should enjoy it. We should enjoy it. Okay. I was telling to somebody, this is a difference between allopathy and yoga therapy. Fine. In allopathy, while we are taking a medicine, we did not enjoy it. Okay. Even without the enjoyment, if you take that thing may peripherally get cured. Okay. But in yoga therapy, while we are practicing asanas or pranayama or mantra japa, all these things, oh, what is this? We have to do this. No other go, I must do this. With that mentality, if we do, that will not become effective because yoga is not this action. Yoga is not mere an asana. Okay. Asana is an exercise. This exercise can give you a bhavana. This exercise can remove your thoughts and make you to stay in peace. And that state is yoga. That state, you are trying yoga through this asana. You are trying yoga through the japa. Fine. So, if you don't accomplish that state by these practices, then there is no use of this practice. Fine. Thinking something and doing this asana, that doesn't work. While doing asana, you have to enjoy it. Complete involvement in it. The same way, doing japa, with complete mind, at least for 10 minutes. At least for 10 minutes. How it's possible for 10 minutes without thinking anything, with complete involvement to be in japa, how it's possible? Somebody asked me, I said that's a simple technique. This is my personal experience, I'm sharing it with you. It's a very simple technique. It's possible. Whenever some thought comes, what kind of thought will come? Oh, I have to do this. Mainly this kind of thought comes, at least to me. Okay. I don't know about others. At least to me, these kinds of thoughts can come. Okay. Okay, tomorrow I have to do this. This planning. Mainly planning comes. Perhaps it may be true with you people also. Generally, when I sit in meditation, if at all disturbance comes, the thoughts come. These thoughts are not about the past. Okay, it's not about the present. Of course, regarding present, there is no thought. Fine. So it's always about future. Planning. Tomorrow I have to go to Singapore. Yesterday when I was sitting in meditation. Tomorrow there is a Gita conference. Gita Jayanti, for that I have to go. That kind of thought can come. Or today itself, my child is crying that I have to go. I'm sitting here from meditation. I have to take care of a child. Or this thing has to be done today. This thing has to be done. That thing has to be done. Some milkman has come, so I have to run out. All these kinds of thoughts may come, and some thoughts can become unnecessary also. Okay. Okay. We are not needy. Even without us, things can run. But what we feel, somehow or the other, we wish to come out of the meditation. That's why we are searching for thoughts. We are searching for those kinds of thoughts. Fine. But interesting suggestion. An auto-suggestion we can give to put off that thought. To give up the thought, if you give this auto-suggestion, then the things can work well. What is this auto-suggestion? Hey, my dear, even without you, the world can run. When some thought is coming, no, a milkman has come, we have to take the milk. If something like that, if some thought is coming, yeah, just for 10 minutes we are searching. In these 10 minutes, even without you, the world can run. If this suggestion can be given in our mind, then without any kind of disturbance, we can freely sit in meditation. And gradually what happens, this space of meditation starts to grow without our own knowledge. 10 minutes meditation, in the beginning it may be bored, but in due course of time, our interest gets developed. We love to meditate more. Then this 10 minutes meditation grows. It becomes 20 minutes. It becomes half an hour. It becomes 40 minutes. It becomes an hour meditation. That's how it grows. And then, well, every day we sit for 10 minutes or half an hour, that's okay. But it comes to such a level that throughout our work, from day to evening, morning to evening, day and night, everywhere, wherever we work, in whatever work we are getting involved, in all these things, we develop the ability to be in silence, okay, to be a witness, and to be calm. This ability is developed gradually. Okay. For that, the simple technique is this: every day, at least for 10 minutes, we have to sit quietly. If this can be done in due course of time, gradually the silence expands, also in your actions, the silence expands. That is how this karma yoga comes. It's interesting. Generally, karma yoga is sadhana and dhyana yoga is sadhya. And I am putting this in a different way. By this dhyana yoga, karma yoga grows. Okay. There are two kinds of karma yogas. One sadhana way of karma yoga, another one is sadhya karma yoga. You understand these two mean words, sadhana and sadhya? Sadhana means practice. Okay. Sadhya means the target which has to be achieved, that is sadhya. Sadhya karma yoga is there, sadhana karma yoga is there. To attain chitta shuddhi, to attain heart purification, to get knowledge, to get jnana, one practices karma yoga. This is sadhana karma yoga. Fine. This is what we do. After attaining jnana, being in that jnana, enjoying that core nature of us, staying in that, doing action. This is sadhya karma yoga. This is what Krishna does. Okay. These are the two kinds of karma yogas. That is Krishna's karma yoga. About both Krishna is talking about. Fine. Krishna is talking about his own karma yoga. Ajo visannavyayatma bhutanam iswaro visan prakritim swam adhishtaye sambhavami atma mayaya sakta karmani avidvamsaha yatha kurvanti bharata kuryat vidvan tatha saktaha chikirshur loka sangraham. Generally, ajnani is also work. Ajnani is also act. Krishna says here, jnani also has to work like ajnanis. Sakkaha karmani avidvamsaha yatha tatha vidvamsaha cha. Jnanis also have to work like ajnanis. Ajnanis may think, he is also an Ajnani like me, therefore he is also working. He may think like that.
Both are working, but the difference is not in the work. In mentality, difference is there.
An Ajnani works to gain profit, to gain benefit for himself. The Jnani works for Lokasandraha. Lokasandraha means universal welfare. And Jnani works for universal welfare. Kuryatu Vidvanu Tata Asaktaha. Asaktaha means a Jnani doesn't get attached to that action. Without getting attached to that, a Jnani works. In that way only, I am working. Okay. I am beyond all these actions. Namam karmani limpanti. Actions cannot bind me. Actually, Krishna says this. Okay. Namam karmani limpanti name karma phale spruha. Actions cannot bind me. And I am not going to get benefited by any action which I am doing. But I do. Because there is a phrase, there is a proverb in English, do good because it is good. Okay, this is karma yoga. I am seeing people getting happy, for what I am doing. For their welfare I am doing. This intention, this mentality is here denoted by the word asaktaha. Kuryatu vidvan tatha asaktaha. Now let me come to the very nature of Brahman. Brahman's nature is a wonder, Krishna says. Wonder of the wonders, he says. Ascharyavat pasyati kaschidenam. Ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyaha. Ascharyavat chainam anyasrunoti. Sudvapyenam vedana chaiva kaschid. One listens to it. Ascharyavat pasyati, in a wonderful manner. Ascharyavat vadati, another one delivers a discourse of Brahman in a wonderful manner. Ascharyavat chainam anyaha shrunoti and pasyati. One sees it in a wonderful manner. Sripapyanam, even after listening to it, na veda, one doesn't understand about it. These are all wonders about the Brahman, Krishna says. And its dual nature, Brahman's dual nature, Amrutam, Murtyuhu. Okay. I am mortal and immortal. Sat, Asat. I am manifest and unmanifest. Asaktam, Satabhrut. I hold everything but I am beyond all. I am attributeless and I am the whole, I hold the attributes. Nirgunam, Gunabhoktru. I illumine the Indriyas but I am devoid of Indriyas. Sarvendriya Gunabhasam, Sarvendriya Vivarjitam. I am in and out, Bahirantaschaya. All these statements are coming. This is the dual. So, Brahman itself is an oxymoron. Okay. How this is possible? We don't know. Simple answer. How is it possible? Sorry, I don't know. But this is possible. This is possible. How do you say? Because We see it. Okay. We see that being in pure consciousness, the work can be done. Okay. So, it's possible. This is a yoga experience. Okay, fine. Okay, leave this yoga experience. You come to this ordinary world, trivial world, let me give another example. Very simple example. These sleepwalkers, you may be knowing. One who walks in sleep. And their walking is perfect. You know this? When we walk, in our waking state we are walking, no? Even we may meet accidents. But a sleepwalker never meets with accidents. His walking is perfect. This is what a medical report says. How this is possible? That is not an ego. I am walking. That ego is not there.
And this guide is not there. This I faculty has to guide here and there. Go there, the bus is coming, auto rickshaw is coming, leave this place, going left. All these things, this I fellow has to guide along. This I is sleeping. But this fellow is walking without any accident. Then we should understand there is some faculty beyond this I which is guiding this body. What is the scientific explanation for this? There is some faculty beyond this body which is guiding us. So, if that faculty can guide this body while sleeping itself, then why not in samadhi? In samadhi also they say, no, being in samadhi one can act. Okay, his mind is completely acting to samadhi, but body is acting, body is working. This also is possible. That's one thing. Another example, scientific example let me give for this dual nature. Leave this Brahman just in our trivial world, mortal world. Scientists are talking about light. Fine. Light has dual nature. There was a huge debate in physics. Some scientists said that light is a particle. And some other scientists say that light is a wave. It's a long debate. Many researchers consider it as a never-ending debate. But this debate got concluded in a great scientist's laboratory. The scientist's name is Schrödinger. Schrödinger concludes it. He says, after a deep research, he says, it's not just a statement, blind statement. After a deep research, after a deep investigation, he comes to the conclusion, light, is it particle or wave? What's the conclusion? Light is wave as well as particle. Light is wave as well as particle. How? Answer is same, we don't know. But you see, light behaves both as wave and particle. You see. And this cannot be disproved because through the scientific instruments we see. Fine. This cannot be disproved. But how, what is the mechanism? It's beyond our reach. The very external nature itself is beyond our reach. Leave alone this Brahman. External nature is beyond our reach. Nature is cheating us. Probably, perhaps, that is why he discovers Maya. Maya is cheating. Nature is cheating us. Okay. Well, we are seeing it appears to be stable, this chair. Okay. There are lots and lots of changes which are happening. Now itself. Lots of atomic changes are happening here. We are not viewing it. Chair is cheating. That's what this is why. We can only gradually understand. Immediately if the chair vanishes, then we can understand the world is anityam. Easily we can understand. But this nature is cheating us. And nature's change is very, very gradual. Therefore, we think nature to be eternal, nature to be shashvata, natural elements to be shashvata. Fine. That's how the problem is created. And as the nature cannot be caught, when we move towards the nature, nature is not revealing herself. Therefore, this theory, for that reason only, this theory is called as uncertainty theory, Heisenberg's theory. So, nature always doesn't give a determined mind to us. Light is particle as well as wave. If this can be found in the external nature, then you come to this point, what Krishna is talking about, or what Ishavasya Upanishad is talking about. Brahman is both manifest and unmanifest. Brahman moves and never moves. Brahman is both mobile and immobile. It is there. It is there. It's interesting. Now, so for a few minutes, let me take a
few minutes and explain all the reconciliation things. Whatever questions we saw in the beginning, let me give answers for that. Shall I take some 5 more minutes? Karmanyeva atukhavaste maapuleshu kathachanaya. Don't get too much attached to the karma. Point number one. Conquer Duryodhana and enjoy this kingdom. If you cannot conquer, then enjoy the heaven. These two statements appear to be contradictory. No? How to synthesize this? Krishna doesn't discourage enjoying the result. This we have to understand. Krishna doesn't discourage enjoying the life. In fact, Krishna encourages enjoying the result. Yajna shishtasunaha santaha muchyante sarvati pishaihi, Krishna says. What's the meaning of this? Enjoy the life as prasada. Yajna shishtasunaha. Yajna prasada. Do the actions and if the results come, enjoy that in the attitude of prasada. That's how Krishna says. Therefore he doesn't. Krishna himself will enjoy. So he doesn't say don't enjoy the results. He doesn't say. But what he says is don't get bound to the results. Don't always be result oriented. Always result. For that result I have to do. For that result I have to do. When we are getting educated, enjoy the education. Of course, examination also will be there. Prepare also for examination, but don't always be bookish and only for that examination I have to prepare and these questions I have to, what is the word? I have to mug up, suppose Kolakay word in India. I don't know whether it is in Singapore or not. We have to mug up this. Don't do that. Enjoy the education, okay? And prepare for exam also. Okay, that's the idea. So he never says that don't enjoy the results. He doesn't say. Therefore he encourages Arjuna and says, Hatova Parsase Surdam Jitvava Bhokshasyamani. After conquering the evil, enjoy kingdom. That's what Krishna says. Here, next contradiction. Vedaischa Sarvaihi Ahameva Vedyaha. All the passages in the Vedas are talking about divine and divine alone. Krishna says this. Then, there are scholars who get stuck always talking about the results of rituals, prescribing these rituals based on the Vedas. They are Vedic scholars only, but they don't go beyond those rituals and ritual results. They are not Munis. This is Krishna's statement. Here also, Krishna is not condemning the Vedic literature. To Krishna, Veda is his life breath. But he is just, okay, he is just condemning the result orientation of the ritualists. Okay. Ritual is good. Ritual is good. Ritual has to be performed. Krishna supports rituals too. Krishna himself performs rituals. But always to be a ritualist, getting stuck to ritual, that Krishna is talking about, I am not condemning the Vedas directly.